presentation looking at some of these elements, prefaces, introductions, marginalia, that were included in Luther Bibles. So more. One thing to ask is, what do we mean by scripture? You know, we're talking about the scripture alone. And one thing I want to point out, as I've already said, that at its most basic, the Bible is a material object, a book that is produced by people. Here it might be important to distinguish between text and book. So when we say text, we normally mean like the ideas of an author that are embodied on a page. And by book, we mean something a little bit more specific. Books are material objects of folded, what people and historians call quires. So a quire are pages that are put together and folded, and then you would kind of staple them and then put these together and bind them together to make a book or a codex. So a scroll is rolled, but a book is folded. That's the basic difference. When we think about books in this ways, they're created by means of specialized labor and equipment. It's not just an author putting their ideas on a page. Many more people were involved in the production of a book as a material object. I also want to say further, when you think about texts as books, the meaning of the text cannot be separated from the object in which it's conveyed. So this is the argument that, you know, media impacts the message. So printed words were always mediated through material objects, even when texts claimed to be the very words of God. These material objects almost always contained readers' guides, as they do today, that were intended to facilitate readers' response. So think of study Bibles, think of chapters and verses, think of table of contents, notes. These are readers' guides that are meant to aid the reading. The same was the case with the first Bibles that were printed by Martin Luther. All right. I'm actually going to skip this because and just stick with the reader's guides. Okay. So by reader's guides, I'm throwing out a fancy term here. In literary studies, they refer to these as paratext. So you have the text, and then paratext is whatever's surrounding the text, titles at times, marginal notes, footnotes, indexes, images that editors or other people or even authors put there to help facilitate and guide reader response. So you see here on the screen, this is a foreword to the Old Testament. So a preface or a foreword is also a paratext that is placed there by the author or the editor to guide the reading of the text. So here's some paratexts that were in Luther Bibles: title pages, prefaces, dedications, marginal notes, appendices, illustrations. And as you'll see in Luther Bibles, there's no verses. Chapters are here at this time, but there's no verses. So chapters and verses are paratextual elements of scripture that were added later to guide organization of the material. One of my favorite paratextual elements of Luther Bibles are what we call woodcut images, the pictures. Woodcut is how they're made. It was a block of wood that was carved, and then ink was put on it, and then it was pressed on the page. So the carved elements were the negative elements where the ink did not soak. I have a picture here of a modern Luther Bible that was printed in 2017. And as you'll see, it's just a text. This might look like your Bible you read, you know, the NRSV or something. But then I have a picture on the other side of an actual 1534 Luther Bible of what this passage looked like in Revelation. And Revelation has, I think, 17 of these very interesting pictures. And I just think, I mean, I don't know, this is one of my, I think this is the most striking thing for me when I compare early Luther Bibles with modern Lutheran Bibles is the images are gone. And it's just the text. So the Luther Bible contains a dedication to the Elector of Saxony. In this case, this is John Frederick I, So, you know, there's the politics of the Reformation front and center on the front page. Obviously, this gets excised. So I'm going to walk through the Genesis woodcut images. And these are the first images in Genesis. It starts with creation. Here's the image that the Luther Bible begins with. And so the color is added by a later artist. So if you would have just bought the book, the Old Testament Hebrew Bible, it would have been black and white. And then you would have had to color it in yourself or pay an artist to color it. So this is a scanned copy that I found online that was colored. The next image is Genesis 3, and you have Adam and Eve in the garden. You know, you see God in the background, the snake. And this is depicting eating from the tree of knowledge and good and evil. And then behind you see Eve and Adam, or maybe I think that's Eve, in their nakedness and the shame, and God speaking to them. And then on the right side of the image, you see the angel with the flaming sword driving them out of the garden. This is one of the interesting things about early modern pictures, is they simultaneously portray multiple events at once in the same image. And so here's the next image. What is this a picture of? This is Cain and Abel. Again, you have the multiple layered images. And then you start to see, you know, the progression after the fall. Here's sacrifice, murder of one brother of another. Another image of judgment. This is the flood. You know, it's very dark. You see the rain, the shame covering faces, the death. You know, so there's death in the last picture, death in this picture. And then a small glimmer maybe of hope with the dove up at the top with the olive branch. And again, if you see these pictures are placed.
Do the images stay this dense throughout the volume, or is it just in the beginning and the end?
No, it does not. Very good question. Genesis and Revelation are more dense. I think that, like I said, there's 17 images in Revelation. So Revelation is the most heavily illustrated book, but Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus are fairly heavily illustrated, and then it falls away. Once you get to the Gospels and the epistles, it's pretty much just an image to introduce each book. And Revelation is heavily illustrated. And so, no, it's, I mean, I'd have to, this is 1534 Luther Bible, and this is the Apocrypha. And, you know, it's just like there's, each book has maybe an image to introduce it. This is Ezekiel. And then it's not this dense. So very good question. So here's Malachi, you know, there's a picture to introduce it, but yeah. Genesis and Revelation are more dense. Yeah, and also I want this to be helpful to you guys. So I have the material I've prepared. So if you have questions on Zoom, feel free to interject just like Nelson just did. Okay, so after the flood, the next image is the Rainbow Covenant. This is really interesting as well. You also have simultaneous things going on at one time. You have Noah's nakedness. That's a very strange scene from the Old Testament, you know, that I know. And you have God's promise, you know, so you have the shame, the sin, and the guilt, but then you also have God at the top pointing to the rainbow. And I think the reader's eyes are drawn from that image of the shame of the nakedness towards God's promise of the rainbow covenant, is what I've called it. And obviously this image is very light, where the other ones are very dark. And that contrast between light and darkness is something that hopefully I'll talk about later. Sodom and Gomorrah, again, we have judgment. It's the sacrifice of Isaac. So again, we're still just in Genesis. This is Jacob's ladder. This isn't a unique one, not just unique in me thinking it's unique that they illustrated this, but actually it's unique for Bibles of the time to illustrate this story. Jacob in the roods or rods, separating the spotted goats from the non-spotted ones. This is a strange story to illustrate. So sometimes it's fun to just look at, why did they, the other ones like, okay, big significant event, but why this event? Why illustrate this one? Jacob wrestling with the angel or God. All right, I've moved Joseph and Potiphar's wife. Joseph and Pharaoh's dream. And that's it for Genesis. So one of the questions I have, and I'm not an art historian, but is like, are these just illustrations, just pictures, or were they meant to guide readers' understanding of the text? How interpretive should they be? Did they spend time selecting, no, this event should get a picture or not? And it's an interesting question for me. And for me, I'm drawn to the images when I look at them. And I think 16th century readers as well, especially illiterate ones or children, would have remembered the pictures and maybe would have been drawn to the pages that had images on them more so than ones without them. For sure, there were scholars who were reading it or pastors that maybe weren't the case. But I think at least popular reception of the Luther Bible, the images were very, very important. And these are something that fall out and change over time. And obviously these images were not produced by Martin Luther. So this kind of troubles the idea of authorship of a single author of a book. You know, we have multiple people who are involved with producing this Luther Bible, and one of them is an artist. Okay. When I'm thinking, I want to stick with the theme of pictures for a minute and introduce you to a kind of, you could call it, devotional Bible that Luther produced in 1529. And this was, as you see here, it had one woodcut image on the left side and a summary Bible verse on the right side. And it was a story picture Bible that Luther made that had 50 of these pictures from creation to the last judgment. And Luther intentionally intended this for laity to be a kind of lay Bible. And so as you see this quote at the bottom, Luther says, "What harm would there be if someone were to illustrate the important stories of the entire Bible in their proper order from a small book, which might be become known as the layman's Bible or the lay person's Bible?" Okay, so I want to walk through these pictures with this question in mind. Obviously, this becomes more interpretive. You know, just illustrations? I can't spend all the time I would like to with all of these, but here's the first, the next image. So this is God breathing life into Adam and Eve. And you have very similar progression, the fruit, the snake, the fall, being cast out of the garden. Again, you have the flood, the Ark of Noah, the judgment, the dead bodies, the olive branch, the promise, similar juxtaposition going on. Again, you have Sodom and Gomorrah, judgment. I missed one. Passover. This I we're getting into ones that I didn't look at the other one. So this is Exodus now. But I'm not skipping any with this one. This is the progression of this lay Bible. Then you have the Red Sea with, you know, literally the trumpet up there of fire, or the pillar of fire. That's one of the interesting things when it says pillar of fire. They literally have a pillar in the fire. okay. This is Moses receiving the law. I don't know if you guys have any of you look at old art, but Moses kind of has horns here. And for a long time, even like Michelangelo's depiction of Moses has horns. A lot of old art of Moses is horned. And I'm not a Hebrew scholar, but the Hebrew word where it was translated in the Latin Bible as horns, like with horns. And so people thought Moses was given horns on Sinai. So this is something that falls away from, it's like a medieval in reading of how the Vulgate translated it. So if you just search, Google search, if you're interested in this, Moses with horns, you'll find stuff. This is the manna, also in Exodus, giving of the manna. Okay, so this, the bronze serpent in Numbers. Here we have another juxtaposition of a symbol or a sign similar to the rainbow covenant that's being pointed to, but in this time it's a snake on what looks like a cross, and the judgment and the death going on simultaneously. So this is the last image of the Old Testament or Hebrew Bible. And then it jumps right away from this to the Annunciation. So here it's the angel greeting Mary, the spirit in the form of a dove over Mary. And the angel speaks to her. Luke 1. After the Annunciation is the visitation of Mary to Elizabeth, her cousin. Okay, and then I'm stopping here. I'm not going to go through all of the pictures. One, I haven't prepared them on my slide to do this, but I want to think for a minute about this transition. You know, there's so many other stories that they could illustrate in a lay Bible from after Numbers. So why are they stopping? Why does Luther in this lay picture Bible stop at the bronze serpent and then transition immediately to the Annunciation and the Visitation? I'm going to offer some of my theories on this. I think, you know, this is obviously influenced by my understanding of Luther's theology. One, there's a progression from judgment to promise, like as we've been seeing, or law, the judgment of the law, to gospel. Another thing we see is there's a switch from a visual symbol to a spoken word. So in these texts, it's emphasized that the angel is speaking to Mary and saying things to Mary that will happen that are unbelievable. And then likewise, in the Visitation, for some reason my PowerPoint is not skipping. I want to sit with this image for a minute. So the Visitation image emphasizes the speech of Mary in the listening ears of Elizabeth. It says Mary, if you see at this top paragraph, that bottom one, und gruset Elizabeth, and greeted Elizabeth. And then in the other one, and when Elizabeth den grus Maria hurit, when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, you know, the child, das Kind right there, leapt in the stomach. So Mary greets Elizabeth And when Elizabeth hears the greeting, and this was a passage that Luther loved to preach on, and I've written an article on this, the visitation, as to illustrate the power of the spoken word. So he says it was the greeting of Mary, and he says, you know, he speculates that the greeting must have been, you know, shalom, peace. And this is a truncated form of the gospel. And it was this spoken word of the gospel that caused Elizabeth to be full of the Spirit, for her to recognize the Christ child within Mary. And so Luther preaches sermons upon this to illustrate faith, that faith comes from the speaking of the word. And So in these cycles of images, I see not only a transition from a visual symbol of the serpent to the greeting of the angel to Mary, and then Mary in turn to Elizabeth, a transition from a visual media to a spoken one. I also see a transition from what Lutherans call law gospel. You know, you have all these pictures of judgment and the visual sign of judgment to the spoken gospel of the birth of the Savior. It's, and then the tidings of Mary that are causing Elizabeth to be illumined by the Spirit and recognize the Christ child within Mary. Is there any, I want to just pause here for a minute. I've gone through a lot of images, and we've looked at the first woodcuts in the Luther Bible. I've asked, are these just images? Are they interpretive? And then I transitioned to this 1529 lay Bible, and have obviously, at least with this one, tried to say that these pictures are selected and are telling a story in a theological one. And I've offered a little bit of interpretation in terms of an emphasis on a visual image and spoken words and law gospel. Are there any questions or comments at this point on the images themselves? Or clarification points that would be helpful, or another picture you just want to look at for a minute? And it's fine if not, I'll just keep going.
Random thought, I have some of the way the folds of the clothing down by their feet are the clouds behind them. Some of the things almost have the shape and texture that you'd expect for angel wings in this one.
Let's look back at the angel. That's an interesting observation. Yeah, and the angel is, you know, a messenger sent by God to Mary, and then Mary is the messenger, presumably, you know, to Elizabeth. So yeah, there is that connection. Yeah, I also love the visitation, because I think there's this one rare moment in scripture where it's two women talking to each other, and Mary is the preacher of the good news. And obviously, you know, it's a story about the two sons in their wombs, but I think this is a fun day in the church calendar. July 2nd is the Feast of the Visitation. And yeah, it's one of my favorite stories. Other thoughts, questions?
I was wondering, at the time of these Bibles, what portion of the population was literate?
Yeah, I don't have a statistic off the top of my head, but it's low. So literacy is very low. So the portion of the population that were literate were university clergy and the mercantile. Most of the mercantile, like working class, had a kind of what we might call like a proficient, like they could read for what they needed for their work, in certain documents could write their name and keep a ledger, but we can't presume that they were sitting down reading Latin in the same way or German in the same way that an educated person was. I think most of the nobility could read and write, but yes, it's much lower. And I don't in my notes right now have a percentage, but low. And then it's, the question is, most peasants, I think, are all functionally illiterate. And so how people come across scripture then, and even in the Protestant Reformation, is a big question, because we have all these assumptions surrounding, like, oh, the Gutenberg printing press in the 1540s, and then this led to this destabilization of Catholic hegemony, and they started translating the Bible in the vernacular, and there was this mass media dissemination, and people were reading the Bible for the first time. And it really doesn't map onto rates of literacy, nor does it map onto how Bibles were actually produced, which is, there is no mass media, even with the Gutenberg printing press, until steam engines, because it's still hand-pressed. You know, so it's not a machine doing it. It's more standardized than handwritten, but it's, you don't start seeing mass media arguably until the steam engines were helping doing the printing. That's just my thoughts on question of literacy. But then it's a very good question of how do people come across these texts then in the Bible passages? And can we assume that there were places where someone in the family was reading out loud? Was there one literate person per family? And that was their role to read out loud? Maybe it's hard to assume things, and you have to have evidence for them as a historian. If people were going to church, they were certainly hearing, you know, the liturgy as it was being done in the vernacular now, and reading of scripture. And so one of the things I love to think about feast days in terms of what people would know, because here, you know, given the church calendar, the people would have been aware of, because they have off work on these days and other days, you know, like the Annunciation, the Visitation, and the stories surrounding them at church, I think people probably would have been familiar with. But yeah. Miguel, do you have a follow-up thought on literacy?
When I see these images, and I see when I go down to South America in the churches there, they have lots of images there. And it's a lot more visual. And whereas the Bible today, like you're showing, it's just the words. So this type of image reminds me of when I go down to South America and I see, they do definitely have images. And so I was just wondering how people learn, because today we're all, most people are educated, at least in the rich countries. So in the poorer countries, it's not necessarily the same way. And Germany at the time, I mean, today Germany is, you know, a developed country, but I'm going to say back in those days, it was not. So I'm just trying to put myself in the shoes of the person at that time. So.
Yeah, I think that's a helpful comparison, not only with the Catholicism of South America, you know, that tends to be more image friendly, but then also with, you know, different classes of Christians. And I think it's one of the things we forget about. And there are differences between Lutherans and more Reformed Christians. I think Reformed Christians were a little more cautious about visual images, especially in their churches. So, you know, they saw it as idolatrous. And Lutherans were a little bit more open with the visual arts, with images of Mary. They kept more Mary feast days in the calendar in Lutheran lands than, and they tend to say, whichever ones were clearly talked about in scripture, we're going to keep. So the Annunciation, the Visitation, and other ones, but like the Assumption of Mary or things like that, probably not. It's not biblical. So yeah, I think, but when I study 16th century, even, I mean, here, I'm going to just, it's not the same thing, but one of the things even the Reformed tradition. So this is a facsimile of the Geneva Bible, which are published by English emigrants to Geneva. Like, it's not as image heavy as the Luther Bible. And for me, it's boring because of that, but its images tend to be like maps. But it's just as heavily, or so here's an image of, like, I think it's the tabernacle or something. They're much more, less creative. It has all the like marginalia notes. By this point, we have verses. But there are the other things I mentioned: prefaces, introductions, marginalia, indexes. Those paratextual elements continue in the Reformed Puritan. This is like, I would describe this as a Puritan Bible. This Bible is there's an epistle in the Geneva Bible to Queen Elizabeth. So you also have, you know, the dedication letters to the nobility, who they're trying to procure favor from through these works, and to persuade their politics. So, but no, I think, if I'm to be honest, like, I work more in Lutheranism, and I think Lutheranism of the Protestant traditions, and, you know, the Anglican Bibles could be a little different, I don't know, as well, tends to be a little more visually rich than their Reformed counterparts. Any other thoughts or questions about the images before I move on?
Yes, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not the best analogy, but one analogy to think of, like, is like, how did early modern or medieval illiterate people learn Bible stories? One way to think about this, and this is an analogy, you know, it's not exact, is to think about how my kid or children learn Bible stories. And it's not the same thing, but my son cannot read, although he thinks he can. And he knows Bible stories. So because he hears them, you know, and he goes to preschool and looks at pictures and knows these characters. And so I think it's this really weird, it's this interesting thing where you can have someone who's, you know, biblically knows a lot of Bible stories, but it's not reading the Bible for themselves. And so I think there were similar situations of people who were illiterate, and if it was saturated in their culture, these stories. And sometimes we don't give enough credit to late medieval Catholicism either for how biblically saturated it could be just with the liturgical calendar and the and stuff. So, okay, I'm gonna move on. And this is just illustrating my points where I was talking about the day of visitation, the spoken word. I'm gonna quote some sermons from Luther. Luther says, the external word must first be heard, and that word must not be left out, as some imagine. For God will not come to you in your bedroom and speak with you alone. It is certain that the external word must be preached and go forth first, and then the word has been fixed in the hearts. The Holy Ghost, the true schoolmaster, has come in the heart and provides the word's power to adhere. I'm not saying this as like I'm endorsing Luther's position that God won't meet with you alone, but to show that as Luther continues to preach, especially after the 1520s, and there's these people he called like more radical Protestants who start to talk more about an inner word, Luther doubles down on the necessity of the external preached word as the cause of faith, and uses the visitation sermon to illustrate this point a lot. Here's another one. Mary speaks an oral word, and her greeting resounds in their ears, this Elizabeth's ears. And as a result, there arises such strength and spirit in John and his mother. Here you see the order when the spirit is supposed to come out, not when you crawl away into a corner separated from the reading of God's word. There's polemics involved in this, but one of the things I really appreciate about Luther's emphasis on the external word is it's scripture, but it's one person speaking to another person. And I think it kind of gives this agency and power to the human voice of like, how do people hear from God? How do people have faith? And one way to do that is you just speak to someone else with your mouth to them a promise from God, the gospel. And that is powerful. And I mean, I'm not going to myself in my theology say that God only comes to people through the external word. But I think I've come to really appreciate Luther's, the kind of agency and power he gives to the human voice in the economy of salvation. All right, I don't have much time left, so I think I'll just kind of go through some of these quickly through some of these other paratextual elements, but they're prefaces as well. And so Luther writes, and these are by Luther, the images are not by Luther, but to every book of the Bible, as far as I know, Luther wrote a preface. And they're very explicit about how they should be interpreted. And so Jerome had done this to the Latin Vulgate. And Luther explicitly has to answer the question, like, why would he be so bold to usurp the position of Jerome and write prefaces to scripture, telling people how they should be read? And this, they were, at least for Luther, they were very interpretive. And Luther's reason for why he's writing prefaces is very interpretive. So in 1522, preface to the New Testament, Luther gives an answer of why he's writing prefaces. And he says, quote, "It would be right and proper for this book to go forth without any prefaces or extraneous names attached and simply have its own say under its own name. However, many unfounded interpretations in prefaces have scattered throughout have scattered the thought of Christians to a point where no one any longer knows what is gospel or law, New Testament or old. Necessity demands, therefore, that there should be a notice or preface by which ordinary people can be rescued from their former delusions, set on the right track, and taught what they are to look for in this book, so that he or she may not seek laws and commandments where he ought to be seeking the gospel and promises of God." Okay, wait a minute. So how clear is this book? You know, we attribute to sola scriptura at the beginning, you know, scripture is clear. And now, how much are these Protestants willing to just leave the text in the hands of the people to read for themselves? Here you have Luther saying, you know, people, what is he concerned about? You know, they're reading it wrong. They don't get it. And they don't get the main point. And according to Luther, what's the main point? Here he's saying the main point that people have to get in order to read the Bible correctly, and this is kind of distinctly Lutheran, is what? He says, they don't understand what's gospel and they don't understand what's law. They shouldn't seek laws and commandments where they ought to be seeking the gospel and promises of God. And so Luther, through the production of these Bibles, through prefaces, and I will argue also through the font eventually of the Bible itself, and this gets crazy, Luther tries to guide the reading of scripture to distinguish between what's the promises or gospel and what's the law. And these two should not be confused. And so the easiest way to think about this is the Old Testament and the New Testament, but that's not enough because Luther thinks there's gospel in the Old Testament and law in the Old Testament, and likewise, law in the New Testament and gospel in the New Testament from Jesus. It's not just like Jesus's words are always gospel, you know, someone else's words are always law. So this is, he's taking this interpretive principle that's kind of uniquely Lutheran and trying to say, you know, guide the reading of the Bible through these prefaces. I'll stick with the law gospel one. There are some other ones that are, well, I'll show one other kind of crazy one that people probably don't know. Luther also tried to establish a canon within a canon explicitly. So he did this by writing at the beginning of the New Testament. He says, which are the right and noble books of the New Testament? And he says, the Gospel of John, Romans, Galatians, Ephesians, and 1 Peter are the most important books in the New Testament. And as some people know, he had some funny things to say about James. But, okay, so these are table of contents. These are the Old Testament, the Apocrypha. So one thing to note is that all Protestant Bibles in the 16th century had the Apocrypha in them, but they kind of relegated it to a lesser position, but they still translated it and still included it in their Bibles, which is something I think people forget about. So here, look at the New Testament list. I'm sorry for those in the classroom. I don't know how well you can see this, but you should be able to see on the left side, you have enumerated 1 to 23 in Roman numerals. And then each one of the names of these books has saint. So Evangelium S period Matthew. So Gospel of St. Matthew, Gospel of St. Mark, all the way down to the third epistle of St. John. So, and then you have these four books relegated with no number and no saint. And what are these four books? So it's Epistle to Hebrews, James, Jude, and Revelation. And so there's also some interesting things going on with how Luther's paratextual elements, these prefaces, tried to establish certain books that were more important than others. And these relegation of these four books, I think, are having to do, they're ideological. I think Luther, with James especially, thought it was just law. There's no gospel in it. So that's why he calls it an epistle of straw. So Luther's hermeneutic of law gospel is also causing him to favor certain books over others. But also, these are the four books that in the early church, they were kind of unsure of their authorship, some of them. Like, they thought the Epistle of Hebrews was written by Paul. Well, I'm going to end with showing just one quick thing. I mentioned that I think Luther and Lutherans tried to guide the reading of scripture as law and gospel by the font itself. So I'm going to show you some images of this. In the 1540s, very few people know about this. Obviously, why would they? Because if you're going to look at an image of Luther Bibles, you normally look at the 1534 complete Luther Bible. But in the 1540 editions, they started doing this really weird thing. And this is the first time they do it in the New Testament. If you look down at the second chapter, this is Matthew 2, you'll notice in the second paragraph that these, all of a sudden, you start seeing Roman numeral font or Roman font, das der König, when the King Herod heard. Why are all of a sudden at this passage, they start switching these all capital font? So when King Herod heard this, he was frightened and all Jerusalem with him, and he summoned all the priests. So this is a statement of like fear, judgment. I think Luther and law is my interpretation. You see this in the Sermon on the Mount as well. If you look through these passages, you see at the very top, ihr habt gehört, you've heard that the old says to you, you shall not kill. That do there, the D and what looks like a V, do. It's the Roman numerals, you shall not kill. And then, you know, I say to you, and then it's distinguishing the Roman, the law says, I say, through Roman font and Gothic font. And it's really funky. I think this would have been a nightmare to typeset. Because this means the typesetter has to, every page they're placing down, not only have the right letters, but has to make sure they're putting the font right. And someone had to mark up the page with like, this passage should start with capital Roman font. This one should start with capital Gothic font. Let's see here. This is my, I would love to sit and talk about this passage for a long time, but it's a very clear one in terms of law gospel. And this is Romans 3. I've underlined in red, you see the Roman capital letters, and then I've translated a rough translation on the top, but we know what the law says, that wir wissen aber das, was das Gesetz saget, that top paragraph, it says to those under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may be guilty before God. Therefore, no person is considered righteous before God, because through the law comes the knowledge of sin. So you see all den, dirk, das, gesetz, that den is because, and you see Roman. And then you see this transition to, in the next paragraph, to the Gothic, nu aber ist an zutun, das. I have a hard time reading these kind of old German things. I get some of the letters. This is the word for the law, confused. But now the righteousness that is valid before God is without the works of the law. And you go down and now it's using the Gothic font. And at the very bottom, I have this highlighted passage. This becomes a very controversial passage in Luther's translation of the Bible, the one with the highlight, with the word allein, which is alone. This is the passage where you see wo bleibt, it's then. What becomes of boasting? Is it excluded through what law? Through the law of works? No, but through the law of faith. And then you see that das der Mensch that's where you see the capital Gothic. For we hold that a person is justified without the works of the law by faith alone. Das der Mensch gerecht würde an des, that's the word for the law, gesetzes Werk allein durch den Glauben. That so that's just to show there's this funky stuff going on with the font itself of saying, and some of it's clear, like in Romans, okay, yeah, this is talking about the law, this is talking about the gospel. But when you get to narratives, like they're also using this as a strategy to distinguish passages of judgment and I think law and gospel as a way to guide readers through the text. This is a Protestant Bible. It's supposedly clear, self-interpreting. And I think a lot of people, when they talk about sola scriptura and Luther being the originator of this, haven't actually looked at Bibles that were actually produced by Luther. And I think sola scriptura means like the primacy of scripture, you know, the elevation of scripture, but it certainly doesn't mean that Protestant clergy just translated the text of scripture and gave it to laity to read for themselves without any interpretive guides. Or that they would have trusted them to do this. Just to reiterate, that word align, alone, is like a big controversial point of Luther's translation, because a lot of people see that as an interpolation of like faith alone. So I've talked almost to the very end. So in summary, I've taken you through a tour of images, some prefaces, emphasis on law gospel. And here I've tried to argue that Luther's hermeneutic of law gospel, which he talks about in the prefaces, eventually wound itself into the font itself to try to guide the reader. And how should you correctly read the Bible? So that's my presentation. I don't know if Nelson, if you want to give time for questions, or I mean, it's 10:44, or if you just want to conclude.
People should feel free to ask or observe more. I think you've given us good food for thought, that if we find a passage that isn't self-explanatory, that there were many who went before us who felt the same way.
Yeah.
Well, while you're thinking of your next question, we can, in our usual habit, ask everyone to unmute themselves and express your appreciation to Sam for sharing these insights with us today. I guess if you want to stop sharing your screen, and
yes.
Carl, if you want to joust with the microphone to mention what's coming up next.
Yes, thanks, Sam, for presenting today. And next week, being with us will be Dr. Wanda Boone, the Executive Director of Together for Resilient Youth and co-pastor at His Feet Ministries and Wisdom for the Way, will present insights on racial healing and adverse experiences.